for a program where success is measured in championships. Stanford versus Connecticut. The story continues at the NCAA Women's Final Four.
A sellout crowd of 21,655 waiting to see a storybook Final Four loaded with legendary programs and coaches, and each club led by a first-team All-American. This is the NCAA Women's Championship, presented on ESPN by Orbitz. Our first national semifinal matchup has the Stanford Cardinal taking on the Huskies of Connecticut. The winner will advance to Tuesday night's championship game to face the winner of tonight's second semi between LSU and Tennessee. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick, Doris Burke. It's great to have you with us. This is a made-to-order Final Four with every element you could think of, the way a Final Four is supposed to be, but very often isn't. And we get to start with Stanford and Connecticut.
This is arguably the greatest collection of coaching talent ever assembled at a Final Four. 14 NCAA championships amongst Pat Summitt, Gina Auriemma, and Tara Vanderveer. And though Van Chancellor returns to the college game after a 10-year absence, he brings with him four WNBA championships. And without question, the four best players in the country are here in Candace Wiggins, Candace Parker, Maya Moore, and Sylvia Fowles. We've got the potential for something very special.
All right, let's get to your first game. What's the star watch?
The most dynamic personality in the NCAA tournament by virtue of her scoring skills and leadership abilities, Candace Wiggins has driven Stanford to the national semifinals. Maya Moore's the best freshman in the country. There isn't an area of the game she won't impact. She scores it, she rebounds it, and she's got triple-digit assists. And this three ball advances them over Rutgers in the regional final.
Gina Auriemma has already won five national championships, the last in 2004. And now he has the number one team in the nation again. Let's meet his starting lineup.
Keisha Soigne. My teammates call me Snack Size and Katia. I love video games.
Renee Montgomery, Nene, as coach would say. People say I'm shorter than what they thought I would be.
Maya Moore, so excited to be here in my first Final Four.
Kylie McLaren, Yogi, Ogre, I still watch Disney Channel.
See ya!
Brittany Hunter, double quad, queen size. I'm from Columbus, Ohio. The Ohio State men's team just won the NIT.
Go.
Yes, sir. Working the sidelines for us tonight, Rebecca Lobo and Holly Rowe. First, here's Rebecca.
Well, Mike, Maya Moore has been spectacular all season long, but remember, she's just a freshman playing in her first Final Four. Coach Auriemma told me today he doesn't know exactly what to expect from Maya. He said her play could run the gamut. She could want to win so badly, want to play so well that she presses. But at the same time, he said she's just a kid, so she might play free and clear with no worries. One thing he does know for sure, it's a lot easier for a freshman to play well when the upperclassmen play well because there's less pressure. With more on Stanford, we'll send it over to Holly Rowe.
Thanks, Rebecca. Well, Tara Vanderveer and her superstar, Candace Wiggins, said, honestly, we have UConn to thank for us being here at the Final Four. You see, the Huskies beat them handily back in November. While the score was only a 12-point margin, the players say it was much worse than that. We were embarrassed. Candace Wiggins said they were so far ahead of us at that time. We learned we had a lot of work to do, so that was the start of a new season for us. So we changed our offense. We changed the pace we play. We even changed our pregame warm-up. They think that they know now what it takes to be an elite team. We'll have to see if they can beat an elite team. Tara Vanderveer should know something about that. She's at her sixth Final Four. Now let's meet her Stanford Cardinal.
Hi, my name's JJ Holmes. Everyone calls me JJ. I kind of know two languages. Hola.
I'm Candace Wiggins. My teammates call me Dub, call me Ice. And I'm a member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority.
Ooh. I'm Rosalind Golden Wooday. You can call me Roz. This is for y'all. Everybody in New York who played ball with me, you're here with me.
Hi, I'm Kayla Peterson. People just call me Kay. I'm very addicted to card games.
Hi, I'm Jana Pell.
My teammates call me Bam Bam. I'm a member of Pi Beta Phi sorority.
A packed house awaits what should be a very special night in women's college basketball. Legendary programs and coaches, All-Americans galore, Maya Moore billed as the next superstar in the game. The best player of 2008, Wade Trophy winner Candace Wiggins awaits, and a sellout crowd here in Tampa in the first semifinal. Gino Auriemma, Tara Vanderveer, both with national championships to their credit. This should be fun.
Now you've got a Stanford team that is representing the entire West Coast, and in particular the Pac-10. It has been a long time, in fact, since 1997, since a representative from that conference has played in this game.
Brittany Hunter in white against Jane Appel in the center jump, and UConn will control Keisha Soignier and Montgomery in the backcourt. Seasoned guards, good scorers, and they'd like to get Maya Moore untracked early. She's number 23. A little strong from Kylie McLaren. Hunter tries to save it and goes down.
Well, right off the bat, Stanford in a triangle and two. And remember in the regional finals, Rutgers went box and one. The person they guarded was Maya Moore. Tara Vanderveer said she thought she might start up straight man-to-man, but they come out in a triangle and two. And the two people they're guarding, Renee Montgomery, who scares Tara Vanderveer, and Maya Moore.
Holmes, who had a brilliant game against Maryland in the regional final, had a career high 23 points. And we get a foul early defensively. Gino Auriemma looking on as McLaren picks up the foul. This is their ninth Final Four appearance, but the first since 2004. And the third time they will have met Stanford in the tournament.
One of the things historically Gino Auriemma's team has done better than anybody else at this time of the year is get the right person, the right shot at the right time. It's something we'll track throughout the course of the night.
Wiggins gets her first two. Two 40-point-plus games in the NCAA tournament this year. Nobody else has ever done that, not just in one tournament. Nobody's ever done it in their career. Hunter with a jump shot that is short. Gold on Woodé with the long rebound. Great pass by Appel. Maybe a little too strong and Wiggins couldn't hit it. They love to pass in the high post.
Well, this is the triangle offense, and one of the areas they have great success is that particular play. Getting Wiggins off a backdoor cut on the overplay by defense.
Soignier left open, buries it. That'll be a key, too.
There's not been a more radical transformation of a guard in Connecticut's history than Keisha Soignier, from a skittish freshman to a controlled senior.
Wiggins, 17-footer. What a touch. That's why she won the Wade Trophy. She has carried this team offensively.
Well, Kara Lawson has said over and over and over again throughout the course of this tournament that the best leader in college basketball is Candace Wiggins.
Montgomery off. Did not shoot well against Rutgers or Old Dominion. Only 2 out of 17 from long range, and they need better than that from her. Holmes short on her first shot attempt. Here comes Soignier on the run. She's always going to try to penetrate. Moore is very patient offensively. She's not going to force anything. McLaren, double team, jump ball, possession arrow, goes to Stanford.
Now, Candace Wiggins will hurt you in a variety of ways on the offensive end. She's got great range off the three, but she's also got this in her pocket, the ability to go either direction off the dribble, and her mid-range is exceptional. So before she has to pull up and get into the lane and maybe face bigger bodies, a sweet jump shot off the dribble.
Two 40-pointers. The others, not particularly impressive. The 41 and 44 is.
It's not bad, but I think the key tonight, because Connecticut generally does a good job with the opponent's leading scorer, is finding other scorers. Appel, Peterson, Holmes, somebody's got to shoot it.
There's Peterson from 17.
Keena Charles is in for the first time. She's number 31. McLaren puts one up, can't hit it. Here comes Stanford again. Beautiful fast break, great pass, and an even better catch by Holmes for the layup.
Well, typically, Connecticut dominates the paint area on both ends, but you've got 6'4" and 6'4" across the front line for Stanford, and the guards will help rebound tonight, a critical factor for Stanford.
Soignier drains it again. That's two long-range shots.
Now, as a freshman, she could not hit a perimeter jump shot with any kind of consistency at all. In fact, she would have never taken that shot as a rookie.
Wiggins, nice move to get free for a three. And a fresh 30 for the Cardinal. Gold on Woodhay, had it blocked. And UConn ball, and Maya Moore tossed it to somebody who wasn't there anymore. Sort of a helpless feeling when you
yes.
toss it and your partner's already gone.
Well, those are the kinds of things that will draw his ire in practice, but more importantly in a game. And he will test you physically and mentally in a Connecticut practice.
Wiggins out of a double team. Peterson drives. That's going to be a blocking foul on Soignier, who tried to draw the charge and comes up a little gimpy.
One of the storylines to watch for both Gina Auriemma and for Tara Vanderveer, these clubs do not have a lot of depth at the guard position, so foul trouble must be avoided.
Soignier right now is limping. Stanford doesn't recognize it, and Appel will go ahead and get the bucket. But Soignier was vulnerable on defense there if they could have gotten the ball to Holmes. From six, Stanford. The officials conferring, and a jump ball. UConn will have it on the possession arrow. 16:47 to go in the first half. Candace Wiggins and Stanford off to a quick start, up by four.
NCAA Women's Championship is presented on ESPN by Orbitz.com. Orbitz, keeping you a step ahead. And in part by the all-new Pontiac Vibe, the official performance machines of the NCAA.
Back in beautiful Tampa, Florida, and a sellout crowd here to see the women's national semifinals. Stanford with the early lead, 10-6 over UConn, behind Candace Wiggins. And yesterday, she was at the Wade Trophy presentation when the winner was announced. The first name was Candace.
One player of the year from Stanford University, Candace Wiggins.
I am completely shocked and unprepared to say anything. Just want to thank everyone who has supported me throughout my career at Stanford, and this means so much to me, and I don't even know how to put that in words.
She also picked up the Senior Class Award, which it was announced at the open practice the other day, and I think she was truly shocked at that Wade Trophy announcement.
Well, I think she's a great representative of the spirit of Margaret Wade, and part of that trophy is how you represent college basketball in general. I think the surprise was, to me, the most talented player in college basketball is Candace Parker. The most versatile offensive player in college basketball is Candace Parker, but the player who has the greatest impact on her teammates is Candace Wiggins. She makes them better, not only physically as basketball players, but she gives them extraordinary confidence so that when they step between the lines, Mike, they feel like they can beat anybody in the country.
And Parker, of course, was the reigning holder of that award. And a lot of people thought she would get a repeat yesterday, but that didn't happen. Let's go to Holly Rowe. Holly?
Well, Dorsey, talk about her leadership, and it's so true. Her teammate, Rosalind Gold on Woody, said, you know, her energy out there is so contagious. You believe you're better when you're on the court with her. She said, I'm the only player I've ever played with that I feel like I've scored 20 points when I'm out there, even if I haven't.
on Woody will unload. Missed everything. Rebound to Moore. We count with a chance to tie or take the lead. Soignier goes inside to Tina Charles, a little jump hook, tied at 10.
Well, Tina Charles is a very capable scorer when she gets deep post position. She likes to turn over that left shoulder.
Averages 14 and a half points a game. Harmon is in for the first time. She has it down low, hit hard and fouled. Rebecca Lobo also working the sidelines for us. Rebecca, what do you have?
With that last UConn huddle, the focus was on screening and movement without the ball. Remember, Maya Moore in the game against Rutgers facing that box and one had 7 points on only 7 field goal attempts. She told me yesterday it's important to get good screens and movement, but it's also important to set good screens. She doesn't have any open shots here today. That last huddle, Coach Oriamo looked at Maya and said, "You're standing there like a dope. Keisha is waiting for you to back screen. You look asleep. You need to do more."
Tough love?
I'll tell you, he will lay it on the line. And I think, as she has said many times, Maya Moore, I came to Connecticut because I knew he would challenge me and make me a better player.
Harmon, they hope she can play well because coming out of or going into the Pac-10 tournament, she had missed 7 games with a stress reaction in her foot. And she averages 6.5 points a game and almost 5 rebounds coming off the bench. And I'm not sure what this delay is. We have 2 different times on 2 different scoreboards. We had that as we went to the break. We announced it at 16:54 to go in the first half. It was actually 15:54. And now one of the clocks still says 15:54, while the other says 14:54. In addition to that, we have a couple of leaks in the roof.
Well, I think Tina Napier was just telling Tara Vandeveer that the clock to our left, so broadcast position left, which is the clock that's correct. I don't think they're able to fix the clock on the opposite end of the floor.
Okay. Well, that's the one that was off to start with, so we will go right now. There's 14:54 on the correct clock, we are told. Maybe the water was coming down on the other clock. More. Tripped on the way in, and that may be on Wiggins. Her first. Moore has such an athletic frame, a lot like Candace Parker, and a lot like Jane Appel. They're really put together as athletes.
A terrific frame, but also terrific emotional maturity.
Soignier had hit 2 three-pointers, missed that long-range shot. Wiggins lost the dribble. Moore waiting for her. That's a good defensive matchup for UConn. Harmon, nice cut down the lane and a great pass to set her up.
Well, yesterday at practice, Tara Vandeveer came over and talked to us and said, "You watch Jillian Harmon." It was almost like she was sending us a message. Expect big things tonight from Jillian Harmon.
Nice little scoop shot. And Shardae Houston was a real factor in the regional. She has been coming off the bench and playing arguably her best basketball in a long, long time. And there's Appel, who they count on to score a lot. 15 points a game. She can't hit that shot. And Soignier off again.
That is a poor shot in transition by Keisha Soignier. A rare, poor decision by her.
Would you rather see the ball go inside?
Well, I think particularly you can get that shot later, and your rebounders hadn't gotten into position quickly enough. Now, Connecticut, generally speaking, dominates the paint area. And Shardae Houston, Tina Charles, all excellent scorers.
Appel and Moore both off the ragged start scoring. There's Peterson. The officials look to each other. The basket counts. And a foul.
Well, great position. You could see Kylie McClara tries to go out over the top. Gets the defender sealed high, does Kayla Peterson. There is a mature pulse to this rookie's game. In fact, they'll tell you this is one of the most mature players on the floor and off.
And that's a big foul because Soignier has picked up her second. And as you pointed out earlier, there's virtually no depth of guard for this club. Peterson with a miss from the free throw line. Soignier back the other way, now playing the two person. Charles. This could be really big for Shardae Houston. She knows this is the last act in her career in Connecticut.
Well, she came in as a gifted scorer. In fact, the all-time leading scorer in California high school history. With some great names, Mike. But her career has been up and down. She has been in and out of Gino Auriemma's doghouse. He asked before the tournament started, could she keep it together for three straight weekends? So far, so good. And this is what you get. When you get her isolated on the box, it is very difficult to contend with her. The help comes a little bit late. You allow her that close a touch, and she will get to the free throw line or make the basket.
She is 6'1 and powerful. Peterson. Got the front of the rim on the three. Here comes Hickson. She's been the first guard off the bench for Gino Auriemma. Moore from behind with a block, but recovered by Holmes. Appel wants the ball inside, but Onwuede is wide open, and she knocks it down.
She's going to be very selective with the shot she takes. But in the regional semifinal against Pittsburgh, when they needed points, Pittsburgh did a sensational job defensively. They gambled off her, and Golden Moody hurt them with 15.
Stanford on top by four. Houston has one roll out on her. Peterson looks in from the high post. Holmes to Appel. Backs in on Charles with a left hand. Charles, good job on defense and boxing out to get the rebound. Charles will try one from 17, too strong. Wiggins, even though she is slight, is a very, very good rebounder. Better than 4.5 a game.
She has drastically changed the WNBA draft. Every team below the third pick is trying to trade up to get her.
Appel with a reverse and the roll.
She's got to be more of a factor. She comes into the tournament averaging 21. She's a little bit slow up the floor here.
Yes, she is. She has played like she's been tired since the game started, and she's really gasping for breath.
She was just hunched over, Mike, after crossing half court. This was Connecticut's game plan, and exactly what they did to her early in the year when they met in the Virgin Islands. They sprinted her out of the gym in the first half.
Well, she is already gassed. Wiggins is not. Didn't get the roll on the jumper. One and done.
She's never gassed. Wiggins.
No. No, that's why she holds all those records. Charles, beautiful jumper.
And now, see, to me, the quick shots by Connecticut. If I'm Connecticut, I go to whoever Jane Appel is checking every trip down because she's too tired to guard anybody right now.
Stanford with the answer. 22-16. The Cardinal on top by six with 9:57 to go first half.
Well, 6'4", Jane Appel comes in averaging 21 points in the NCAA tournament. She is 7 above her average in the postseason. She has got to be a major factor. Golden Moody hits the jump shot. Then they go inside, start from the outside, go in.
Telecast available in striking high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Olivia. Gino Auriemma has had a tremendous impact on college basketball. He and the UConn Huskies won their third straight championship. Then they lost to Stanford in 2005. It's been a slump since 2004. They lose to Duke in the Elite Eight in 2006. In 2007, they lost to LSU and big in the Elite Eight. But Gino once again has the number one team in the nation and favored to capture another national championship here in Tampa, Florida.
Well, you question where the scoring comes from now if you're Connecticut. It's got to be Renee Montgomery right here or Tina Charles.
Megan Gardler, number 22, is in at guard. The sophomore out of Springfield, Pennsylvania, making a rare appearance.
This is a lineup I've never seen from Connecticut. You've got Lauren Dixon, who has played minimal minutes in the games in the NCAA tournament leading up to this, and Megan Gardler, two non-scorers on the floor for Connecticut right now.
And Stanford going without Jane Appel. The center getting a well-earned breather on the bench. Shot clock nearly expired and a poor shot from outside by Harmon. Tipped and didn't get anywhere near the rim. Good defense by UConn. Charles loves that jump hook. That's such a great touch on him.
Terrific patience. You do not have to score on the first post entry touch. Give her the basketball. Let her kick it out, Mike. Reposition. Get a little bit deeper. Patience on the offensive end. This is the number one shooting team in the country in Connecticut. They haven't shown it thus far.
And you have to wonder with this lineup where the scoring is going to come from. It's certainly not going to come from the backcourt. Beautiful three by Wiggins. That was a long three, and she knocked it down. Candace Wiggins with seven.
Great range, and she gets it off quickly. Her release point isn't necessarily that high, but because she pulls the trigger so fast, it's a non-factor.
Gardler, whose strength is she doesn't make mistakes. To McLaren. Charles. 10 to shoot. Dixon didn't want it, then got into the lane and knocked it down. Nice shot by the young lady who averages 2 points a game.
That is one thing this staff has tried to get out of Lauren Dixon all season long, the willingness to take shots, and that is the player Stanford is choosing not to guard right now.
What a bonus if she can score. Hones has been a non-factor offensively. Peterson short on the jumper. Offensive board goes to gold on Woody. Peterson trying for a back cut, and down goes the All-American. Candace Wiggins showing us so far why she is an All-American, leading the Stanford Cardinals. They have a 5-point lead on the number one team in the country, the Huskies of UConn. Matt, thanks very much. Stanford on top of UConn right now, 25-20. I think if you told Gino Auriemma the 12 and a half minutes into this ball game that Montgomery would have 2 points and Maya Moore would have none, he would be happy to be down a handful.
Yeah, no, there's no question about it. Maya Moore, 17 points per game coming into this. Renee Montgomery, in the absence of the two starters, Mel Thomas and Kalana Green, who went down early in the season for Connecticut, they've taken the majority of the shots.
Moore back in. She knocked that one down. She has a great stroke.
Well, so what do you do as a coach? She's struggling a little bit. You take her over to the bench. You get her to take a deep sigh and say, okay, let's watch for a few minutes. Let's get our composure back, and let's go back at it.
Foul away from the ball in the lane. Hope they'll stay around for the second women's Final Four matchup next on ESPN. Sylvia Fowles and the number two LSU Lady Tigers against Candace Parker and the defending NCAA women's champ, number one Tennessee Lady Vols. NCAA Women's Basketball Championship presented on ESPN by Orbitz.
They split their regular season matchups. And Peterson drains another shot. This is a player who, as a rookie, you do not speed up or slow down. Kayla Peterson is going to play the game at the pace she wants to play it.
Peterson with eight. The lead has grown to seven. Montgomery back in. Soigne still on the bench for those two first half personals. Montgomery, ouch, missed everything. Dixon playing the role of point guard, so the shot clock is still running. Forced the shot. Maya Moore with the rebound and knocked it down. What a shot.
She didn't even have a footing. It looked like her leg buckled a bit underneath her as she tried to get up with that thing.
Just a freshman, already an All-American. She could be one of the greats that we have ever seen in this game. Hones got it. That's what she did against Maryland. She was devastating from the outside.
And career high 23 points, both from three and off the one dribble bounce. She was aggressive with her mindset early, Holmes.
Appel back in the ballgame. Moore starting to feel. Can't hit that one. And Wiggins has a rebound for the Cardinal. Stanford playing with a great deal of confidence right now. Appel, after that rest, sets the screen for Wiggins. 8 to shoot. Rimmed out by Gold on Woody. Had a good look at that three. Dixon penetrates and draws a personal foul.
Now, Maya Moore has an ability to rebound the basketball on either end of the floor. Remember, Connecticut runs very few plays for Maya Moore. She just goes and gets things done on her own. Does not have great balance as she goes up with that, so terrific job finishing.
Jayna Pell gets her first foul, and Moore did pretty well scoring until the Rutgers game when they played a great job on defense and denial, would not let her have the ball to start with. She was limited to 7 points on seven shots.
Now that was one thing Tara Vandeveer said when we met with her on Friday. She said, I like the box and one, but I just feel like Montgomery is too important a piece to ignore her completely, and that's why you've seen some triangle and two here in the first half by Stanford.
Dixon knocks down both free throws. She made the All-Big East freshman team.
And now Connecticut comes with their 2-2-1 pressure. And the reason they're doing this is they would like to play this at a faster pace. Jayna Pell is back, so they'd like to fatigue her some more. Good job by Stanford to continue to be patient.
Haven't seen much of Appel's great passing ability yet. Newtown's done a good job on her shot clock down to four. Peterson too strong on the three. They were forced into a bad shot there. Moore, nice catch, and what body control. Back the other way, Appel. Got it.
That's called cherry picking. Appel was too tired to get up the floor, and her teammate spots her on the opposite end.
As she realized she was not going to be able to get down and play defense, and when she saw the ball turn over, she had a big advantage on everybody.
So Stanford is very concerned about Connecticut's transition game, so they're sending two players back on the shot. And they're only sending three to the glass.
That thing was halfway down before it rattled out for Wiggins. Dixon pushing. Almost lost it. Good recovery by Shardae Houston. And they'll reset to 17 on the shot clock. Dixon is giving them quality minutes right now, and that's huge. Moore, nice catch. And this is going to be a foul, I believe, on Houston. It is.
Maya Moore competes on both ends of the floor as well as anybody in the country. She challenges this shot, makes it a tough one for Kayla Peterson, and sprints to the opposite end. And Renee Montgomery, one of the best point guards in the country, finds her, puts it on the money, in rhythm, goes right to the rim. Pretty.
Major causes of high mileage engine breakdown. Drive it forever.
Maya Moore, forward.
I'd probably be doing something in music if I didn't play sports. I love to sing. You know, I pretty much sing everywhere I go. Now, singing on camera is something that I don't do yet. I play the drums. I don't know many people know that. I'm not really, really good, but I'm decent.
Maya Moore, a multi-talented young lady who has incredible basketball skills.
Had great emotional maturity as just a freshman. And Tara Vandeveer saw the effectiveness of the junk defense Rutgers threw. So she comes with her own junk, a triangle and two defense. Maya is being guarded by the first defender. Gino Auriemma does not believe, like some coaches, in going away from the two they're guarding or trying to prohibit from scoring. So he goes right to her. She makes the right read, a curl, Mike. We'll continue to watch how they attack that triangle and two that Tara's employing.
So far, it has worked rather well. 34-28, Stanford on top with 3:37 left to go in the ballgame. In the first half, rather. Holmes brings it up against the hounding defense of Dixon. UConn trying to get it done on the defensive end and increase the tempo here. Peterson left alone, and she made him pay. Kayla Peterson with 10 first-half points, the Pac-10 Freshman of the Year.
Mike, we had her in her second collegiate game, which was nationally televised against one of the toughest defenses in the country in Rutgers, and she was sensational in that particular ballgame. You knew right away, kid could play, and she was poised.
36-28, Montgomery. King of Charles, offensive rebound against Appel. Check in with Holly Rowe. Holly?
Well, Doris, you keep talking about the pace of this game. Every single Stanford huddle, Tara Vandeveer has talked to her team about the pace. It's right where she wants it. She said, this is the pace we want to be playing at. We're not in a rush. Don't hurry. Take your time. Just when Connecticut was trying to speed things up there, she did make one point, though. You've got to get back. You've got to haul your you-know-what. She wants to keep the pace right where they're liking it.
And she sent that message earlier. Move your backside. You have got to cut Connecticut's transition opportunities out.
Reach in steal by Shardae Houston, and she is fouled to prevent the breakaway layup on Tuesday. Tune in at 7:30, our NCAA championship preview special, followed by the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship game. For live stats and game recaps, go to NCAA.com, the home for all 88 NCAA championships. Reach in foul was on Holmes. Per second, they're starting to add up for Stanford. Appel goes to the bench. And they bring Jillian Harmon back in at 6'1 to play inside.
Now we know why Harmon is so important. I think Tara expected Connecticut would get the pace where Appel would become fatigued.
Charles couldn't handle the pass from Maya Moore, lost it out of bounds. And here comes full court pressure by UConn. Now they back off. Wiggins will bring it up. Montgomery waiting on her. Got a double high screen. Good step out by Houston on defense. Cold on Woodhay trying to drive, had it blocked, but lost out of bounds to Stanford.
How about the ability of Maya Moore to avoid the contact, to hang long enough? Despite Golden Moody doing a great job shielding, that is just great athleticism by Moore.
Shot clock at 6. Wiggins lost it out of bounds. Good reach-in defense by Montgomery to get a piece of that and prevent the drive.
Mike, that's one of the most difficult things in basketball to do. I don't care what level you're talking about. Contest somebody who's got a jump shot and still contain when they balance that with the ability to drive it.
Houston drive Holmes way outside. Harmon, as the shot clock was expiring, missed a three. UConn's defense has really been cranked up.
Number one in the nation in field goal percentage and field goal percentage defense. Connecticut does the job on both ends.
Charles triple teamed in the pivot and foul. Kayla Peterson picks up the foul. That's her first. And it will send Charles to the line on the 1-1, where she is not a particularly good free throw shooter. Sophomore from Jamaica, New York. She has been an all-star at every level of her career. The National High School Player of the Year, Big East Freshman of the Year.
And Mike, Tina Charles, the player that everybody inside and outside of the Connecticut program will tell you, Gina Auriemma is harder on than anyone in his history. Which, when you know how tough he is on his player, is an extraordinary statement.
Rebecca Lobo has more on that. Rebecca, you've seen it firsthand.
And adding to Doris's point, Coach Auriemma yesterday, for the first time since the NCAA tournament started, spoke to Tina Charles. He's been that frustrated with her. He told us in practice today, I gave her love yesterday. What does love mean coming from him? At the All-American announcement, he told Tina, who was not up there, you know why you're not up there? Because you don't want to be. You need to be tough all the time when you step out there between the lines.
Some players can take it better than others. Harmon rewarded for her hard work earlier in that possession.
How about the unselfishness and the vision of Candace Wiggins to give that up?
Montgomery, a long, long three. Well, that's got any league three range written all over it. 38-31, Wiggins pulls up and missed everything. Look at frustration on the All-American's face. And UConn will take a timeout. Stanford won the national championship twice. It's been a while, 90 and 92 and 90. Jennifer Azey had 17 points, 5 assists in the title game. Stanford defeated Auburn 88-81. In 92, Val Whiting, 16 points, 13 boards as they beat Western Kentucky 78-62. Vanderveer's team won second championship in 3 years.
You can see what has happened since the 97 season. Tara Vanderveer fell in love with the game at age 7, Mike. So desperate was she to get around the game. There were no organized women's leagues or girls' leagues in the 1960s. So desperate was she to become a part of the game that she volunteered as a 7th grader, Mike, to be the high school mascot for the boys' basketball team. Guess what happened? She got fired because she kept taking the bear costume off to watch the game.
Well, good for her. Coming up at halftime, Trey Wingo, Kara Lawson, Stacy Dales. They'll have Van Chancellor on the set and the first half analysis of this game. Van Chancellor, of course, will be coaching his LSU club against Tennessee in the second game of our national semifinals. I guess when you look at Tara, when she wins in 90 and 92, it's the kind of thing you start to expect. Well, I've done it. I've won a couple of national championships. I'm going to get back here all the time. But for a lot of people, it doesn't happen again.
Well, I don't know that Tara would ever admit to this, but she gave great service to the country in 1996. She took a full year off to go ahead and spearhead the longest tenured USA basketball team to play together. She wins a gold medal. But in the aftermath of that, being away from her program for a long time, there was a drop-off. You are not immersed in the milieu of your program on a day-to-day basis. That has to take its toll.
Charles partially blocked from the weak side. Peterson may have gotten a piece of it, but it will be Stanford basketball. The last foul was on Charles, going for that loose ball after it was blocked, and now 1-1 for Jillian Harmon, the junior from Oregon. Hits the first. Candace Wiggins working on a double-double here in the first half. 9.7 boards, and just for good measure, she's thrown in 4 assists.
Yes, not a bad stat line, is it? Goes beyond that too, Mike. It's beyond the numbers, her influence on the psyche of the people around her.
Harmon hit both shots. Biggest lead of the ball game for Stanford at 40-31. Moore contested three, short off the front of the rim. Offensive rebound and a foul.
Great pursuit of the basketball by Sharday Houston. This is a player, Sharday, who strings together plays typically in a 2, 3, or 4 set.
That foul was on Peterson, her second. So a lot of Stanford players have chalked up 2 personals here in the first half. Sometimes in games like this, it takes a third scorer, somebody coming off the bench, to really change the balance of power. And Sharday Houston could be that player for UConn. And Stanford will not even try that last shot. The Star Watch update, Wiggins and Moore. Certainly Wiggins has won the battle early. 9 points and 7 boards. Here's Rebecca.
Coach, second game in a row, you faced a junk defense and having some struggle scoring. How do you get into a more of an offensive flow?
Well, it's the same thing that happened last game. We're way too quick. You know, guys have... You know, they find themselves open and they just shoot it, and we're not given a chance. We're not giving our offense a chance to create anything and make the defense have to defend us. We just come down and take quick shots. I thought it was better, you know, later on in the half, but I got to find a way to slow my guys down.
All right, Coach, good luck finding that way. Now with Tara Vanderveer, send it to Holly Rowe.
Coach, how has this pace helped your team out to a 7-point lead at the half?
Well, we know Connecticut is so explosive that we really have to play transition defense and not come down and jack up early quick shots. So I think the tempo is a good tempo for us right now.
All right. Thanks, Coach.
Okay.
We're at halftime of the women's Final Four. Our score, Stanford 40, UConn 33. And now we'll go to Trey Wingo, Carol Lawson, and Stacey Dales for our halftime report.
All right, Mike, thanks. Welcome in as we are at the break, a break where Stanford finds themselves up by 7. Guys, I'm looking at the stats. UConn, for the season, their defense averages about 19 turnovers against the opponent. In the first half, Stanford only has 1, Karen.
Well, it's come from patience, and patience on the offensive end from Stanford. And Tara Vanderveer said it there. They had to counteract the transition game offensively for Connecticut. How do you do that? It comes with patience on the offensive end. A lot of people think patience means running the shot clock down. That's not how Stanford utilizes patience. It's about going through their reads within their offense. Hustle play here by Golden Wude. It's not a quick shot jacked up. J.J. Holmes sets it. She sets it. They find a back door with Candace Wiggins. And that play on the offensive end, those type of plays, has allowed Stanford to be so methodical and score points, Stacey.
And, Kara, if Stanford was patient, Connecticut was not patient. Gino Auriemma just alluded to it. There were two focuses this week for Connecticut in practice. One, get great shots. Two, get touches in the post. Neither of those things have happened in the first half. Take a look at the three-point opportunities, 2 for 9. From long range, Keisha Soigne held it together for them, but Connecticut wants to get touches on the inside. Even if your post player does not score, you manufacture points. You gain flow within your offense because you get the ball in that painted area. Gino Auriemma, look for his team to come out in the second half attacking the basket, Trey. They've gotten to the free throw line. That's keeping them in it.
They had a couple of threes from Keisha Soigne early in the half. Sometimes that's bad news because you think everybody can hit them. By the way, this is only the fifth time all year UConn has trailed at the half. The previous four times they did go on to win that game, but Stanford playing very well. This is just the first of our two national semifinals. Coming up in just a little bit, it'll be LSU and Tennessee. And when we return, head coach Van Chancellor of LSU, walking into our picture right now, will join us to talk about that. Third time's a charm for these two SEC teams. Stay with us. We're coming back. More at the half with Van Chancellor.
The stride for 5 comes to fruition. The LSU Lady Tigers, their 5th straight Final Four.
Coaches have changed at LSU, but one thing has not changed. They are in their 5th straight Final Four, and joining us now on the halftime show of the first national semifinal is LSU's head coach, Van Chancellor.
Van, I heard a comment from you earlier this weekend where you said, all this talk about what went before us is not healthy for us right now. 4 straight losses in the national semifinal game. How have you handled the approach for tonight's game with your players?
The day I got the job, I said, I don't want to know what went on yesterday. I'm only interested in what we're going to do today and tomorrow. Forget about what you didn't do in the other 4 times. We're going for a national championship.
And the first day on the job, you took this team to a practice gym and did something special. Tell us that.
I carried them in. I asked them each one to get me to cut down a piece of net and then say what you're going to say to you guys. I did. I used y'all's name. I said, what are you going to say to ESPN and tell them after we cut down the nets for a national championship? I wanted them in that thought process.
Well, they are in that thought process because they are here playing for another national championship. One of the big things that's going to be a matchup in the second semifinal coming up is Candace Parker and Sylvia Fowles on the inside. You know she's got the injured shoulder. How do you approach defending her knowing that that shoulder is bothering her?
We have not mentioned that to our team. I don't want to let down in case she comes out of the game. We're saying she's full speed ahead. We got to do everything we had to do in the previous 2 meetings. She's a great player. I mean, you're not going to stop her. Just don't let her have 35 or 40.
Now, we saw Sylvia Fowles dunk Saturday in some of the practice. She's 6'5", 6'6", as athletic as they come. Have you ever said to her, you know, you go free to do this in a game anytime you want now?
When I started coaching her the very first game, I said, Biggin, if we're going to win, you got to dunk in a basket in a game. Here's why. I wanted her to be aggressive. She dunked against Rutgers and missed it, and we got beat 1-4, maybe 2. But I'll take that every time.
so much of the play of your team in this tournament has been spurred by the senior point guard, Erica White. What has she meant leadership-wise as well as basketball-wise to this team this year?
All year long, when we won big games, Trey, we've come back and we've said Erica White did a great job of leading our team, getting us into the offense, and she is the most underrated defensive player in the country.
Well, she's been great. Stace, I know you have something you want to ask.
Well, Coach, everybody probably wants to know. I mean, Candace Parker's a great player.
Yeah.
But who's the next player that you have to take out of the mix in this game in order to win?
I think it's a combination of two players. Bobbitt in the SEC game really hurt us with the three ball, but Hornbuckle is the heart and soul of this basketball team. Great defensive player, can do it all. But when you look at them, you talk about Parker so much for Tennessee guys, but they got a lot of great players. Pat Summitt don't recruit anything but McDonald All-Americans now.
Hey, Coach,
wait a minute,
see the rings?
Maybe one notwithstanding right there.
That's
hey,
that's the ring, right?
We see the rings, Coach. You don't wear those rings often. Those are WNBA championship rings. Why are you wearing those now?
I don't wear the rings very much. I don't wear them in my personal life any. But when it came playoff time, I just put on my rings. I didn't say a word. I just began to kind of take them off and on, you know, and look at them and rub them. I told them they can get a lady's ring, but if LSU wins it, I'm going to get the biggest ring they make.
This is a little motivational tool. Well, you've got a game to coach coming up in a little bit, but your thoughts on what you've seen so far from Stanford and UConn?
I said that Stanford had to score a lot of points, guys, to win the game because Connecticut's so good offensively. Right now, if you're Stanford, you have to be worried about UConn's athletes wearing them down with about 4 minutes to go because Moore can just score from anywhere at any time, any place. I think right now the score favors Stanford, but I think Geno will make some defensive adjustments at halftime.
Well, it has been a Stanford first half. You got to go. You got another job to do. Thanks for stopping
good
by,
luck,
my
coach.
Friend.
Thank you.
Just playing while you're not caring.
You're welcome anytime. We give her grief every day. She deserves it. It is all Candace Wiggins and Stanford at the break. Three for her here. The Cardinal by 7 over UConn at the break.
In Tampa.
All right, Matt, thanks very much. Second half coming up in just a little bit. What is critical for UConn, Kara, in your opinion, down by 7?
I think controlled aggression coming out of the gates. UConn notorious for their runs right after halftime. Stanford, if you can weather that run, love their chances coming down the stretch, Stacey.
Yeah, in the first half, I thought Stanford, the pace was in Stanford's favor. I look for UConn, like you said, Kara, to come out with the aggression. They're going to do it with full court pressure. I expect more full court pressure defensively from Connecticut in the second half.
This clearly not a pace UConn fans are used to seeing. They average over 80 points a game. They barely have 30-something at the half. Maya Moore has 6. They're going to need more from her in the second half. Coming up after this.
The NCAA Women's Championship, presented on ESPN by Orbitz, is brought to you by the all-new Pontiac Vibe, the official performance machines of the NCAA, and the Home Depot. You can do it. We can help.
Everybody want it, but it ain't that serious. So if you don't do it just like this, like this.
Welcome back to the NCAA Women's Championship presented on ESPN by Orbitz. It is 40-33, Stanford on top of UConn as we get ready to start the second half. And we want to take a look at today's Home Depot coaching adjustments. Right now, Geno Auriemma is the guy who has to be making that adjustment.
Well, just like in the regional final against Rutgers, he is faced with a jump defense. It's not a box and one on Meyer Moore. It's a triangle and two. And so you're guarding two players from Connecticut. There's a triangle. You're trying to take away Maya Moore and Renee Montgomery. But you can be aggressive in other areas. Lauren Dixon goes right into the post where Tina Charles has got isolation. I think they've got to be aggressive, Mike, in the second half, attacking that triangle.
Wiggins, 9.7 boards, 4 assists, tremendous first half. Kayla Peterson, a top-flight second scorer with 10. Nobody in double digits for UConn, but Tina Charles came off the bench with 7 points and 5 boards. And if you hear us laugh every once in a while, we are going through an unusual situation at our broadcast position. We are being rained on indoors, which is only slightly unusual. Wiggins, backdoor cut, offensive foul, no bucket.
Terrific rotation. That was a major key for Connecticut coming in, taking backdoor cuts away from Candace Wiggins. So why are you a good defensive team? Because you team defend. Your defender, Marinae Montgomery, gets beat. Rotation over into the spot. Maybe a little frustration on Tara's face. I thought I sensed a little frustration on your face as well. You didn't like the call?
I thought on the replay that she might not have been set before the offensive player went in the air, and that's not charging. Moore, nice.
See, she just goes and makes plays. They do not run plays for her, and we saw this in a regional final where a couple times she just shoots the gap, gets strips, and turns it into points. She will make her own good fortune, Maya Moore.
She has great body control, gets in the air and just glides. This one's knocked out of bounds to UConn.
Now, this is a player who, again, I cannot say enough about how hard she plays on every possession. She tracks down a rebound. We've seen several examples of her terrific athleticism. A little bit of a layout on that layup. It's great extension.
Montgomery, right from the top of the circle. That's where you want to shoot it if you're struggling.
And to the points that both Kara and Stacy made, one option you have to speed the tempo, as Stacy said, is pressure. But Connecticut doesn't have to control the tempo for the full 40, Mike. They did not against Rutgers. I thought Rutgers had good control for a long time, but in stretches.
Appel, good pass into the corner. Holmes set up for three and knocked it down. Appel has been virtually invisible on offense, but that time she got the assist on a three.
Mike, how rare is it that a center, a true back-to-the-basket center, has 100 assists? That's what Appel has.
She said one of the reasons she is such a good passer is because she played water polo in high school, and that'll teach you to pass. She played in front of the goal. You got to tread water the entire time, so it builds up your strength and endurance, and it teaches you how to pass the ball overhead.
The other thing it does for you is it makes you hold your hands above water. So Jana Powell gets that 6'4" frame up and wide, and it's Gino addressed that today, so it's very difficult to contend with that body type when she is extending her arms.
Good defense by Stanford. Appel with a loose ball. Gold on Woody. Tries to get it inside. Forced to pass into a double team. Swanya, who only played 7 minutes in the first half because of foul trouble, got that ball on the end line. In case you joined us late, we had some leaks in the roof here. It was affecting play before the game, but they were able to stop that leak. Now we've got leaks on top of us. If somebody would kindly bring us an umbrella, we'd appreciate it. Yes, we're indoors, but it's raining.
Good thing neither of us is the Wicked Witch of the West, or we'd be melting in here.
Speak for yourself. Peterson. Got it.
Boy, I cannot be more impressed with this young lady. 6 for 10 from the floor. Not playing at all like a freshman. Relaxed, confident. In fact, that's the demeanor of the entire Stanford team.
She has had 3 out of 4 games in double figures in the NCAA tournament. Tonight, she's got another one. And that time, Brittany Hunter, very patient, got a good look and couldn't finish.
Now, that was one of the things Coach Oriana stressed to Rebecca Lobo. Patience on the offensive end.
If this is on Swanier, it will be her third, a reach-in. She's been hampered by fouls this entire ball game. And Gino Auriemma looks on. Do you roll the dice and leave her in there?
Well, what's interesting is, as you mentioned, she was on the bench. Lauren Dixon had played 9 total minutes in the last 3 NCAA tournament games. She played 13 in the first half. Does he go back to her here?
Wiggins couldn't control the bounce pass. Montgomery, pull-up jumper short. Follow is good. McLaren, really nifty feet for her size.
Great feel for the game. I'll tell you what, she hit her teammate. She cleared out with it. There's your turnovers by half. Bad start.
And McLaren will commit a foul on Appel. And you saw the turnover story. It's remarkable that both teams only have 5, but they have changed roles here in half number 2. Appel will go to the free throw line, 73% shooter. A player, Tara Vandeveer says, has not even scratched the surface of her ability. Let's go go to Holly Rowe. Holly?
Well, you talked about her water polo experience. She played for 3 years on her high school team. And look at this. This is a big woman keeping herself afloat. And there's that hand position you're talking about, hands above the water. I talked to her father, Joe, before the game, and he said, it was bloody out there. That's one of the places she learned to be very physical. She got her swimming suit ripped off 3 times. Talk about physical in the post. How about physical in the pool?
Water polo, Holly, is a nasty sport. Usually only see it in the Olympic years. Oh, great pass by Moore to Charles. What a beautiful dish.
So unselfish. Terrific read. Understanding off the dribble. Help defense at a premium. Somebody steps up. Somebody's open.
9 for Charles. Wiggins trying to get untracked, and that one is partially blocked. UConn has really ratcheted up the defense. That time it was Montgomery. And the Wade Trophy winner got away with a big-time push-off to get that wide-open shot. Montgomery back the other way. No. Appel with a rebound. Here comes Wiggins. Soignier waiting for this time with those 3 fouls. Appel trying to back in. Well, the defense has really shut her down. Look at the speed of Soignier trying to push it. Moore, great move to get open, missed the shot. Moore slashes inside. Charles wasn't ready for it and lost the ball after McLaren had made an earlier move.
Connecticut trailed by 7 at the half. They've creeped a little bit closer. They're trying to get their All-American. Maya Moore, just a rookie. Pretty shot. Kylan McLaren follows that one. They're within 5.
This game being brought to you in stunning HD, presented by Olivia. Sylvia Fowles entering the building, and she will crank it up next against Tennessee. This will be the 3rd time these teams have met. LSU wins the first game, 78-62. They were down 21-2 in that game. It was the biggest lead ever blown by Tennessee in their basketball history. Tennessee came back, won the second game, 61-55, and Candace Parker exploded for 28. Check in with Holly Rowe. Holly?
Guys, okay, so let me just give you a glimpse into Candace Parker's day. This morning she had breakfast and went straight to rehab. She had to do modality exercises, stimulation, range of motion, loosen her joints, and then get a massage, then ice after practice, rotator cuff exercises. It goes on and on. So anyway, they've been working on her all day. They think she'll be ready to go. And obviously we'll give you an update when Tennessee plays.
Well, Holly, you know as well as anybody, Jenny Moshak, the trainer for Tennessee, is the miracle worker. Appel had a good look, couldn't hit it, fights for the rebound, can't control it. Montgomery on the run. 9 points for Renee Montgomery, the junior from St. Albans, West Virginia, and the lead is cut to 3.
Connecticut switches into an aggressive zone defense, and Appel gets isolated on the box. Those are the shots you have to make.
Absolutely.
She had one-on-one coverage with that body inside. You've got to finish.
She's averaging 15 points a game and 9 rebounds. She is so powerful, but she hasn't been much of a factor tonight. And in the first half, we saw she was exhausted immediately. Holmes off on the 3.
One and done there by Stanford.
Great bounce pass to Houston. Soignier with a perfect fast break bounce pass.
See what I mean, Mike? They didn't have to control the tempo for 40 minutes. They just need to be able to push the pace and get their runs together. And this defense is really giving Stanford some problems. Let's see if Peterson can't flash to the open area and get a shot.
Really getting nothing inside. That one is tipped and out of bounds with 8 on the shot clock.
Keisha Soignier has game-changing speed, and she gets it up the floor in the hurry. And Stanford's post players not up to the task. See, Connecticut has the advantage in speed, not necessarily size, but speed with their posts.
Peterson. Wiggins, shot clock down to one. Got it off in time, couldn't hit it, and a nice offensive rebound by Harmon.
Terrific.
She's had some big plays in this game.
Terrific pursuit of the basketball. Just be aggressive. Good things happen when you're aggressive.
And Harmon is fouled by Sharday Houston. It's only one on the senior from San Diego, who's gotten quality minutes tonight.
Coach Oriyama upset that they commit the foul. And that's Sharday Houston. She can make several great plays and then commit a silly foul.
UConn zoning right now. Wiggins got it. Passed the ball around the perimeter, and she was wide open in the corner. That's the last person you can leave open.
And that's where they like to run her, along the baseline against the zone. She'll go back and forth across the floor.
Houston trying to step toward the basket. Can't do it. Moore. Well, she does that pull-up jumper move as well as anybody I've ever seen.
Yeah, very few women, Mike, are able to get off their feet and rise and shoot it as quickly and as efficiently as she can.
And she goes straight up. She doesn't drift. Once again, Wiggins out of the corner. Same spot.
So now do you come out of the zone? Because that's two breakdowns on the defensive side for Connecticut. And Gino Auriemma is ripping into his freshman, Maya Moore.
I don't see how you can afford to stay in it any longer. Lead has grown back to seven. Montgomery tries her pull-up jumper, and Wiggins with a rebound.
See what she does. She just controls the tempo again.
Candace Wiggins has waited her entire career to get to this point. It has been a tremendous week for her already. Peterson.
Terrific move. Good ball movement. Overload the zone. And Peterson understands she's one-on-one in the post and goes right at the defender.
Peterson has 14 points. And when Connecticut made a run at Stanford, the Cardinal had an 8-0 run for an answer, led by the Player of the Year, Candace Wiggins. 2 3-pointers in a row.
They're the most dynamic player in college basketball and can score in a hurry and in bunches. Candace Wiggins with great range, and they're in control.
You make free throws, you're my hero. 55-46, the lead is 9 with 11:45 to go in this ball game. Stanford just doing a great job here with an answer to this run.
They struggled early, but watch Candace Wiggins against the 2-3 zone make the cut. Maya Moore on the right side of your screen does not know which player to guard. Initially, she's thinking about coming up high as the ball comes to reverse. But the last player on the floor you want to leave open is the hottest player in the tournament in Candace Wiggins. They did that twice. She's already got 2-3 balls here in the second half.
Twice in a row they did it. Appel will check back in shortly. We're getting a break right now. Moore. Soigne hesitated, then took the shot and missed. Moore had it knocked away. And the ball will go back to UConn. Moore with a touch pass back to Soigne. 15 on the shot clock. Soigne with 6 to shoot. Gives it up. Maya Moore with a shot. No. And the All-American Candace Wiggins with a loose ball rebound.
Remember what Gino Auriemma told Rebecca at the half. He said, let's be patient. Let's go through all our sets and get good shots. Well, that one was coming close to the shot clock expiration. It was a pretty good defensive set by Stanford. A contested shot by Maya Moore.
Wiggins with the double-double at the 10:45 mark. 15 points, 10 boards.
No surprise. Connecticut out of that zone into a man-to-man.
Poland tries to go in with the left hand, and she's fouled. 10 minutes and 28 seconds to go for the right to play for a national championship on Tuesday night. Matt Pat, thanks very much. All-American Candace Parker arriving at the arena. She has only averaged 24 and a half points a game during the NCAA tournament. Fully expected to be the first pick in the WNBA upcoming draft.
Most versatile scorer in college basketball. They do a terrific job of mixing the areas on the floor where they deploy Candace Parker.
Poland hits both free throws. This is the biggest lead of the ball game, 57 to 46. Stanford has looked terrific.
It's a drastically different team that Connecticut faced in November in the Virgin Islands. And Holyrood talked about it. That meeting changed how Stanford approached everything, including their offense. And they have been precise at times tonight.
Montgomery can't hit it. Appel with a rebound. Tar Vanderveer said that was the Stanford JV. We changed everything. And whatever they changed worked. Wiggins, nice pull-up move. Halfway down and spun out. And this is going to be an over-the-back call on Poland. The first on the freshman from Brea, California. Under 10 minutes to go. UConn has been in a drought that's lasted nearly 5 minutes. And they can't afford it to last much longer. Who do you go to score?
Well, they were looking to go straight isolation to Maya Moore, but there's a player that could take somebody off the bounce. Renee Montgomery can create her own.
She averages 14 points a game. Had 21 in her last outing against Rutgers in the regional final. Appel trying to power her way in against Charles in a nice move. That's the Appel we expected to see.
Yeah, back to the triangle offense where she gets one-on-one again.
Pull-up jumper for three, short by Soignier. He's been troubled by fouls all night long. And Gino Auriemma can see it slipping away with 8:45 to go. His kid's down by 11. Peterson maybe overpassed that time, had an open 15-footer, tried to get it to Appel. Maya Moore wants the ball and fires. That's why she wanted it.
Well, she has got to take the majority of shots. Why? Mel Thomas on the right, Kalena Green on the left. Two injuries early in the season. Their best athlete and their best shooter go down. And so Maya Moore, Renee Montgomery, and Tina Charles get the majority of Connecticut shots.
Maya Moore by far the best three-point shooter on this team. 42.9% from long range. And Tina Charles just committed her third personal for UConn. Non-shooting foul. They'll inbound with 8:22 to go. And a holding foul on the inbounds play. On Thursday, you can catch the NCAA hockey semifinals, 6 p.m. Eastern on ESPN2. You'll find complete results from the Frozen Four and the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship at NCAA.com, the home for all 88 NCAA championships. Wiggins. Peterson low, can't control it out of bounds. One of the very few turnovers in this ballgame. That's only 8 against Stanford.
It was the right play. I mean, I thought Kayla Peterson did a terrific job of reading the deny by Maya Moore. Just she led her a little bit too far.
Peterson second in scoring tonight with 14 points to Wiggins 15. Montgomery tries to drive and travel. Houston trying to make a move between a double team and got caught taking steps.
Well, Maya Moore has vaulted herself into the discussion of the best players in the country. Can you ride a freshman back into the lead here? You are under duress. Time is working against you. Do they have it in them?
The NCAA Women's Championship is presented on ESPN by Orbitz.com. Orbitz, keeping you a step ahead.
Welcome back to Tampa, Florida, where Stanford has an 8-point lead on the number one team in the country, the Huskies of UConn. Only 7:59 to go. This is the first national semifinal. The winner will go on to Tuesday night's national championship game to face the winner of our second contest, LSU in Tennessee. And so far, hats off to Stanford. They have answered every run of the Huskies.
Yeah, I think they've played with great poise. They've had a terrific game plan. They wanted to manage tempo, and what a masterful job by a coach who saw a lot of this particular event in the 1990s. When she was a kid, she'd be out on the court dribbling the ball, Mike, pounding away, shooting shots. Her father, Dunbar, said, Tara, come on in and do your algebra. Basketball will never take you anywhere.
Well, for a change, Dad was wrong. Wiggins can't get it to fall. Had a great look. Another offensive rebound. Harmon has done a really good job in there tonight, and that extra possession will draw a foul. Check in with Rebecca. What do you have?
Well, Mike, Connecticut might have given up that offensive rebound because they've gone with a small lineup. In that last huddle, Coach Oriema lit into both Tina Charles and Renee Montgomery. Took Tina out, but not because of her play. He put Lauren in. Said to his team, we're going with a small lineup. We're going to give up size, but now they're going to have to guard all three guards on our end. And now when Stanford inbounds the ball, look for the pressure as well, Doris.
Yeah, that was the point Stacey had made coming out of the half. Could Connecticut go to pressure, get the tempo where they want? Now you've got three players who can attack and score. Still, it remains Maya Moore and Keisha and Renee.
Basket and the foul, and that's exactly what they needed to have. That is leadership.
Well, Maya Moore now 6'13", and you get her isolated against Kayla Peterson. Turn the lights out. That is not somebody who will be guarded in a one-on-one situation.
Appel came over to help, picked up her third personal foul. Moore with a chance for a three-point play to make it a seven-point ball game. Knocks that down, and she has 14.
So the small lineup, three, Stanford zip.
And they threw it away. Moore. Montgomery. That would have been a huge three. Houston somehow missed that shot, and Stanford has it with 7:19 to go.
Boy, Candace Wiggins has done a terrific job rebounding the basketball.
Remember, there is no 10-second line in women's basketball, so you have that advantage. Peterson had it blocked from behind. Maya Moore, excuse me, that was Houston, wasn't it, or was it Moore? She came from the weak side, got a hand on it, knocked it out of bounds.
Terrific athleticism and closing speed, plus she's of the mindset never to give up on a play.
Shot clock does not reset. It's at 9. Wiggins goes to Appel. Appel had it knocked out of bounds. Huskies really working hard on defense. Shot clock is down to 4.
They've got great speed and ability to pressure the basketball. And the way you avoid getting taken advantage of inside is by keeping the action away from the paint.
Goldon Woody comes over to trigger the ball, and they're having a terrible time trying to get it in. Harmon didn't realize the shot clock was winding down and has to fire from a mile out and just hit the front of the net. Got to be better awareness for Stanford of the shot clock situation, especially when the ball was knocked out of bounds twice in the same possession.
Let's see, does Tara change her lineup with Connecticut going as small as they have?
They try the backdoor bounce pass from Montgomery to Moore, well defensed and picked off.
You've got to stay spaced and make good passing decisions.
Wiggins made a mistake and picked up her dribble, bailed out by Tara Vandeveer, who called timeout from the bench.
Well, you have mentioned Jillian Harmon's name all night, and she is trying to do a terrific job. Look at that deny. Goes back to the basket. Look at that. Perfect hand to take away the backdoor cut. That is perfect defense.
That was sensational. She played that way all night long. The NCAA Women's Basketball Championship, presented on ESPN by Orbitz, concludes with the championship game Tuesday night at 8:30 Eastern. The winner of our game, Stanford or UConn, will take on either LSU or the defending national champion, Tennessee Volunteers. Coverage begins with the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship special at 7:30 Eastern. We can't lose. We've got four of the top five rated teams in the country playing here in the Final Four. Whoever wins is going to be really a team that's earned its way to a national championship shot.
And the four best players in the country, including Maya Moore.
Yep. Four first-team AP All-Americans in the Final Four, including the Wade Trophy winner, Candace Wiggins. Here's the full-court pressure. Man-to-man in your face, trying to trap Wiggins. Double-team, gets it out to Holmes. Great pass to Appel. J.J. Holmes with a touch pass. Knew her center was wide open as soon as she touched the ball. She rifled it in there for her sixth assist.
Boy, they just beat the shot clock too, Mike. Good patience. Their advantage is in the post. Can they get the ball there against this pressure?
Moore, speaking of great passes, it's Houston. The defense immediately saw Moore coming, were drawn to her, and she dealt it off.
Well, you can see why Maya Moore has triple-digit assists from the small forward position. She's unselfish. She's a willing passer as well.
She really understands the game in addition to being a terrific athlete.
Two fundamental differences here between the men's and women's game. Turnover again.
Holmes had it knocked away, knocked out of bounds. It is out to UConn. I understand that call. That is either a foul or the ball is out to Stanford, one or the other. There is no force-out rule in basketball.
Looks like he agrees with you here. Two differences you have to be aware of with all this pressure. One, there's no 10 seconds in the backcourt. The other thing is, in women's basketball, the only five-second count you get is on a dead ball, Mike.
Basket and the foul on another great pass from Appel to Wiggins. Holly Rowe, what do you have?
Well, guys, after that last frustration turnover there when Holmes is trying to get the ball up the court against that press, Candace Wiggins, the leader that she is, she ran over to her, grabbed her teammates around her and said, relax, quit stressing out.
Easy for her to say. She's best player in the country. 18 points for Wiggins. Soigne, what a beautiful move. Fouled before the shot. She just exploded down the right side of the lane.
That's why Kara Lawson has pounded on the point that this young woman is the best leader in college basketball, because when things are going poorly, she's going to regroup them.
Foul was on Poland. That's her second. 5:17 to go in this game.
Only the team's fifth, however.
Houston. Beautiful move. Couldn't finish. Offensive rebound to Maya Moore. A three. Got it. What a huge play.
That is ridiculous. Again, pursuing the offensive rebound and then the presence of mind that they want quick scores.
And she went straight out from the lane to the three-point line, turned around, fired, and hit it. Wiggins trying to answer. No. Soigne. 66-59. Got it.
Do you want
Cuts
to use
it to five.
Yeah, I think you need another timeout if you're Stanford, because you're struggling to score big time.
They're struggling to get the ball up. Cara Vandeveer sees the same thing, calls timeout with 4:34 on the clock. She's not going to wait for the TV timeout. I don't think she could either.
No, I think Maya Moore is putting too much pressure on you. Maya Moore tracks down yet another offensive rebound, doesn't hesitate, rise and fire. Keisha Soigne, who was keeping them in the game early, maybe the best speed in college basketball, the pull-up jump shot, and the pressure is on Stanford to keep pace with Connecticut scoring the basketball.
What was great about Maya Moore's move, she got the rebound. She is the best three-point shooter probably in the top 10 in college basketball. She had her mind made up. They needed a three. She could get it. She went straight from the lane to the three-point line, turned around, never hesitated, and it was pure.
And I go back to the point, Mike, that they don't run a lot of plays for her. She's getting 17 and 10. And without them really calling her number every trip down, that's a player who just pursues the basketball, always finds a way to find the ball.
A basket by Soigne, by the way, was her first since 16:43 to go in the first half. She spent a lot of time in the first half on the bench in foul trouble. And Montgomery almost got it. Ball knocked out of bounds, and her teammates hustle over to help her out. And I mean, UConn is going for everything.
Well, one of the reasons they can afford to do this is Holmes is not going to beat you off the dribble. Poland is not going to beat you off the dribble. The only player you've got to be concerned about to create their own is Candace Wiggins. So you can get up in their face like this. It doesn't matter. They're not going by you.
Peterson kicks it out to Holmes. She's being dogged. Poland, shot clock at 9. And Wiggins is the only one who's really aware of it, even if she is. She gets it to Peterson. One on the shot clock. Put it up just before, and Appel with a foul. Boy, that was a break for Stanford.
Well, it's the size differential that allows that to happen. Terrific move by Peterson. Better follow by Appel.
Moore had to pick up a dribble. Gives it to Montgomery. Sets a screen. And the foul is going to be on Holmes running through that screen. And Gino Auriemma was up wanting a call on the other end of the court. And I think Chris Daly, his longtime assistant coach, may have saved him a technical because he was really going after the official. She came out and got him. Stanford and Connecticut here in the first game. Tennessee and LSU waiting in the wings to play in the second semifinal. Four of the top five teams in the country. Four first-team All-Americans. Four legendary coaches in their own right. We couldn't ask for more, and this has been a great game. 68-61, Stanford with the lead. They've been up by as many as 11, but UConn trying to stage a comeback with a smaller, quicker lineup. They have increased the tempo and really put the pressure on Stanford.
Look at Wiggins rebound the basketball. She has been sensational.
Pretty good at 5'11", isn't she? 12 boards for the All-American. And now the clock, a real friend for Stanford. They've got to be careful, more careful with the ball, though. Holmes out of the corner. What a huge three. Holy cow.
She's been really efficient. Averages only 6. She's in double digits.
And she commits the foul there as Montgomery tries to go down the lane. It's fouled. That's 4 on Holmes.
Well, you moved Holmes off the basketball in case you needed Wiggins to have it late to create a shot. And that allows an uncontested 3 with Holmes at the 2.
Holmes hit 9 out of 16 field goals against Maryland, including 4 threes. That was the difference in that game. She has 4 fouls, though, and Tara Vanderveer has no choice at this point but to leave her out there. 13 points for Renee Montgomery.
Now, this is a pressure. You want to make the next easiest pass and stay spread out. Do not allow those quick hands and quick feet of Connecticut to take advantage of your mistakes.
And they'll want to get it back to Wiggins. She's being fronted by Montgomery. Poland left alone. Rims out of 3. 2:50 to go in the game. The lead is 8. Moore makes it 5. Is she something else?
Special, Mike. Rise and fire ability from a dead sprint and the confidence to take a big shot.
Holmes gets it up. 20 seconds to shoot. 2:31 on the game clock. A 2-possession game right now. Poland, good skip pass, good catch, beautiful ball moving. Peterson wide open for 3, and they earned that. 3 crisp, perfect pass.
Terrific patience.
That's almost indefensible. No matter how good you are, that was beautiful ball move.
Well, the ball moves faster than the players, and a very good poise against the pressure by Tara Vanderveer's club.
Nobody dribbled it. They just rifled it.
Get ball reversal. Go into the post, then the kick out because 2 defenders close, and you cannot recover that quickly.
74-66, Gino Auriemma pleading with his club. But there's only so much you can do.
Well, this is a Stanford team that has got to create shots for each other. They've got 20 assists on 27 baskets. These are not terrific individual one-on-one players except for Candace Wiggins. So if they're going to score, that's exactly how they'll score it, by getting each other shots.
She is Stanford's first four-time All-American. She won the senior class trophy. She won the Wade trophy. Trying to win the first Final Four game of her brilliant career. Moore with a miss. Appel with a rebound. Under 2 minutes to go. Wiggins wants the ball in her hand. She's a terrific free throw shooter as well. Here comes the pressure. No foul yet by UConn. Shot clock at 14. Wiggins with a runner.
That was a good decision, because she was the one. You don't want to give it up and have to get it back underneath 10. So Candace made the right choice. They used as much clock as they could before getting into their offense.
Montgomery down 10. This is going to require a major set of turnovers and hitting every three-point shot they can think of in the last 21 for UConn to survive.
Candace Wiggins is a player who will do anything it takes for her team to win. And you know what it took tonight? It took her rebounding the basketball.
And she got a lot of help from Peterson, who kicked in 17 points. Because Appel did not do much offensively for them.
Mike, they become only the fifth team all year to score 70 points on Connecticut. If they get three more, they will be the first opponent against Connecticut to get 80 points. That speaks volumes about their ability to score the basketball.
Wiggins again. 78-66. They have been terrific from the free throw line as well as everywhere else. And Soignier with a long, long three. They get a timeout. That'll enable them to set up the pressure. But they are still down three possessions at 78-69. Hope you'll stay with us for the second women's Final Four matchup. Next on ESPN, Sylvia Fowles, the 6'6 All-American, and the number two LSU Lady Tigers will meet Candace Parker and the defending NCAA women's champions, number one Tennessee Lady Vols. The NCAA Women's Basketball Championship presented on ESPN by Orbitz. These teams played early in the year. Connecticut won in a game that was not tightly contested. It was all Huskies. This one, Stanford has had the advantage since the very beginning. UConn led 3-2. That was it.
Tara Vanderveer told us, and Holly Rowe reported, they changed everything about the way they operated. They completely changed their offense. They changed their pregame warm-ups. They knew that the pace at which they had to play was Connecticut's pace.
Maya Moore with the steal as Wiggins went flying on the pressure. That would have been a big shot. Would have knocked it down to 6 with a minute 7 to go. As it was, she missed it. And we have a foul on the rebound.
Remember what Carol Lawson started this telecast with before they brought it down here inside the building. She said, when you play Connecticut, you must score points. And again, I'll reiterate, no opponent has scored 80 points on Connecticut in their first 30-plus games.
Well, they're third in the country in scoring defense, 51.5 points a game. Appel misses a free throw, and that has been a rarity tonight. They are 14 out of 17 from the line. And Appel is a good free throw shooter. Knocks down the second one. 78-69. Does UConn have another miracle in the bag? Soignier forced to drive, and that's the last thing Stanford wanted to do, is commit the foul and stop the clock. It was on Harmon. Sure, you want to play good defense. You don't want to give uncontested layups. But there's a point. The clock is your biggest friend.
Absolutely.
And now Connecticut being able to score with the clock not running. And if they make the free throw, able to set up the full court press. Well, Soignier has had a really good second half.
You've got to stay spaced against the pressure, and getting it inbounds, you go right to Wiggins.
Dixon in her face commits the foul.
This becomes about nothing more than making free throws if you're Stanford.
And if you're going to do this, and UConn is reduced to this strategy, then you have to make threes at the other end, because Wiggins isn't going to miss many. And you cannot afford to trade baskets. 22 points, 5 out of 5 from the line for Candace Wiggins. And she is our Coke Zero player of the game. She's winning everything this weekend, isn't she?
I was just going to say, she's going to have too much hardware to take home with her.
They'll find a way. Hits the second. 79-71. At this point, still a three-possession game, but they need threes.
And you can defend the three-point line. Take that away and make it beat you with an extraordinary shot.
Moore too strong. Rebound to Stanford. And a foul. Sharday Houston reached in on the double team. And now the Stanford Cardinal fans coming to their feet. They can sense they've got it. With 43.8 seconds to go, it has been a long drought for them. But they're enjoying every moment of it here in Tampa. And to make it better, it stopped raining inside.
With 21 straight NCAA tournaments, two national titles for Tara Vanderveer. Does that group sitting there and the ones on the floor, do they have a third title in them?
Wiggins with 25 and a brilliant floor game. Montgomery from long range. Got it back and fouled by Holmes, and Holmes can't believe it.
Well, was she in three-point territory? Because that would be three free throws.
Sure looked like it. And that's five on Holmes. That'll get Peterson back in the ball game.
Well, J.J. Owens fouls out. I thought she did a terrific job defensively. Clearly, you do not want to foul. So the only time you're going to reach in, and that is all ball. But listen,
yes, it was.
We get the benefit of that second look.
Well, you can tell why she protested the call. Stanford only 35.1 seconds away from going to the national championship game. 14 points for Renee Montgomery, the junior from St. Albans, West Virginia. And she will get three free throws.
Potentially this, and hope that Sharday or Maya uses their athleticism. Unable to do it, Mike. But the turnover by Stanford, and Connecticut lives. You can make it a two-possession game with a three.
Shot clock is off with 29.8 to go.
See, I think you sell out along the three-point line. Contest without fouling, but I would not give up a three. The triple drive makes him use more clock.
Moore unloads, and that one will be out of bounds to Stanford.
Now, Gina Loranda looks at Maya, says, use the dribble to get into that shot. Well, remember, Diana Taurasi lost her first freshman year in the Final Four. Terrible performance against Notre Dame, and went back-to-back-to-back titles after that.
Harmon, they can spend as much time at backcourt as they want. And the Stanford fans on their feet again. The number one team in the country is knocked out here in the semifinals. And Gina Auriemma with a congratulatory handshake for Tara Vanderveer. And she has moved her team into the national championship game and gone 30 5-3, and settled the revenge factor in that first game that they lost early in the year to the Huskies.
Well, she said, we played, the Stanford JV played in that game. What a dramatic turnaround for a team that wasn't in the game in the first meeting. Candace Wiggins, by virtue of her scoring ability, her rebounding ability, and her leadership, gives her chance, her team a chance at a national championship come Tuesday night.
And just about everybody in this game is happy for Candace Wiggins. It's been a long road for her to get here. Take a look at the bracket. Stanford has advanced. LSU and Tennessee coming up in just a half an hour from here in Tampa. The winner of that game will face the Cardinal in our national championship game. Stay with us for the second women's Final Four matchup, LSU and Tennessee. That's just a half an hour away. Let's go to Holly.
All right, how would you describe this team's turnaround from the first time you played UConn till tonight?
Well, first of all, UConn has a great team. And, you know, I just think that we really worked hard against them. They made us do things. We hit some shots. We took care of the ball. We rebounded. And I'm really proud of our team, of everyone, but especially this one right here, who was our leader.
And for you, your team has had to rely on you so often in this tournament. What was it like tonight? Four people in double-figure scoring.
You know, I just think it shows that what a deep team we are, and we stuck together. You know, I wasn't hitting all my shots, but my teammates never stopped having confidence in me. I never stopped having confidence in them. And we stuck together, you know, good times, bad times, and I think that's why this team's so special.
How would you describe your want to in this game? You had double-digit rebounds tonight, girl.
Oh, I didn't know that. Means so much to me. This is my last game I'm going into, and this is such a special moment that I don't want it to end.
All right. Thanks so much.
You can tell just how excited she is, and why not? She had a brilliant game, Doris.
She was the leader.